Hi there. Today we read Chapter 7 of Enid Blyton's The Land of Far Beyond. Don't judge me for reading a children's book. It is a really good one, and I would suggest it to even adults. It reminds me why this has been my favorite, even though I don't remember the whole story. So, shall we continue? Now, in the last chapter, the group of eight did get distracted, giving in to their fears and paying the price for it. Right now, they are following the narrow path to the city of happiness, advised by the guide. But before we continue, if you have landed here without watching the previous chapters, please do so before continuing. Welcome to my space of make-believe. With just words, we shall weave places and people, adventures surreal. I am Tell a Story, and this is an invitation to come with me. Chapter 7, The Wood of Deceit, The House of Lies, Trickery, Bluff and Gamble, The Marsh of Dishonesty, Mr. Straight and the Stepping Stones of Truth. The travellers went along the path and followed its winding ways. Lily and John lagged a little behind and suddenly saw a bag lying by the wayside. They ran to it and picked it up. It was full of money. "Ooh," said Lily, putting her fingers in among the coins. "Look, John, what a lot of money." "Don't let's tell the others," said John at once. "They would only want to make a share. Let's say nothing." "Well, we'll have to hide the money about us somewhere," said Lily, "or we shall be seen carrying the bag. Look, there's a wood nearby. We'll go among the trees and hide the money in our clothes. You can put some in your pockets, and I can slip some into my stockings." The two children slipped aside into the thick wood and made their way to where the trees stood close together. They hurriedly emptied the bag of money and hid the coins about their clothes. "Now, we'll run and join the others," said John. "And mind you, don't say a word about the money, Lily. It's ours, not theirs." But when they wanted to find their way out of the wood, they couldn't. The trees seemed to stand close together and bar their way. The bushes were so prickly that it was hard to get round them. They came to a little forlorn-looking hut and went inside to see if they could find someone to ask their way. But the door slammed behind them and made them jump. They called to see if there was anyone in the house, and some small dwarfs came running into the kitchen. "Can you tell us the way to the narrow path?" asked John. "Yes, if you pay us," said one of the dwarfs, an ugly little fellow with squinting eyes. "We haven't any money," said John at once. "Then you can stay here in the House of Lies until you earn some money," cried the dwarf. "We want servants. You shall be ours. Set to work and scrub the floors for us and clean out the grates." The two poor children were forced to set to work. All the dwarfs but one left the house. The one who was left prodded and pinched Lily and John to make them work more quickly. "What are the burdens on your backs?" he asked. "Nothing," said Lily. "We are travellers. Can't we carry our luggage on our backs?" "That is not luggage," said the dwarf. "Ah, you are good servants for the House of Lies in the Wood of Deceit. You will work well for us. It's a good thing you had no money, or we would have set you free if you had paid us a small sum. Now, you will have to do the work instead of me." He gave John such a push that the boy fell over his bucket and spilt the water. "Mop it up, mop it up," cried the dwarf, really enjoying himself. "Listen, dwarf," said John, picking himself up. "We told a lie when we said we had no money. We have plenty." "Where did you get it?" asked the dwarf curiously. "We found it in a bag lying by the wayside," said Lily. "We thought we wouldn't tell the others, so we hid the money about ourselves. Please let us go, dwarf, and we'll give you some." As the children spoke the truth, the door slowly opened of itself, and John suddenly caught sight of it. The dwarf banged it shut. "That door always opens when anyone tells the truth," he said. "Have you got a lot of money?" "Yes," said John, and the door opened itself again. John caught hold of Lily's hand, and the two children tore out of the house of lies as fast as they could. The dwarf could not run after them because he limped, so they were soon out of his sight. "If only we could find our way," said Lily, stopping and looking this way and that, hoping for a sight of the narrow path. "I wish now we hadn't kept all the money for ourselves," said John. "It was mean and deceitful. If only we could join the others again, I'd share every bit of it with them." Just at that moment, the two children heard shouts. "That's Peter's voice," said John, and he yelled back. Peter's voice came again. "John, Lily, where are you?" "Here, here, we're coming," shouted the two children, and they tore in the direction of Peter's voice. In a minute or two, they came in sight of the narrow path, and how glad they were to see it again. They ran out of the Wood of Deceit and came up to Peter. "Wherever have you been?" asked Peter indignantly. "We've been calling and searching for you for ages. It's too bad of you." Lily was just going to make up some kind of excuse when she remembered the horrid little house of lies in which they had nearly been servants to the dwarfs. She told Peter the whole truth. "We found some money and we didn't want to share it with you, so we ran into the wood to hide it in our clothes and we got lost. We came to a horrid little house called the House of Lies, and some dwarfs made us be their servants. But we escaped, and here we are, and now we'll share every bit of money with you and the others, Peter." "Well, that's nice of you," said Peter, and he hurried them forward. "Mr. Scornful, here they are. They got lost in the Wood of Deceit and were locked up in the House of Lies." John and Lily shamefacedly found all the money they had hidden about themselves and gave it to the others. Mr. Scornful put a piece between his teeth and bit it hard. It broke in half. "False money," he said in disgust, and threw it away. "It's no use. It's just false money made by thieves. And to think we had such a horrid adventure, all because of something that wasn't worth even a penny," said Lily, beginning to weep. "Come on, come on," said Mr. Scornful, who had no patience with tears. "Hurry, we've lost a lot of time looking for you two sillies." They all hurried on again, sitting down at midday for a meal. Afterwards, they had no time for rest, but went on their way, hoping to get to the House of Peace before nightfall. They caught up three people on their way, who bowed to the little company and began to talk. "My name is Trickery," said the tallest of them, a man with bright red hair. "Mine is Bluff," said his brother. "And mine is Harriet Gamble," said the woman with them, a pretty creature with feverish eyes and flushed cheeks. "We are on our way to the House of Peace." "So are we," said Mr. Scornful. "We will travel together. It is good to be a large company in these desolate parts." They journeyed on together. Trickery and Bluff were good company, for they talked well and made the others laugh continually. Soon they all came to a forking of the path, and to the children's surprise, Trickery, Bluff and Harriet Gamble left the narrow path and went down the other one. Certainly, it was a most inviting one, being broad and soft and spread with little flowers. "Hey, you're going the wrong way," called Mr. Scornful. "No, we're not," said Trickery. "Can't you see how rocky and rough the path gets if you take the other direction? This leads to the House of Peace all right. We've often been this way." "Have you really?" asked Gracie Grumble, who didn't at all like the look of the rough path nearby. "Of course," said Trickery, and his bright eyes looked so honest and straight that everyone believed him. "There's been a fall of rocks or something along your path," said Bluff. "No one goes there now. We all take this shortcut. You'd better come along with us, because if you don't, you will only find you can't get along the other path, and by the time you come back here, we'll be gone." "Well, we'll come with you now then," said Anna, and she took Bluff's hand. She liked Bluff, with his merry smile and hearty manner. He had such a sure way with him too, and he made Anna feel safe. She was certain they would be all right with Bluff. "It isn't very far before the path curves round and joins the other one," said Trickery, his red hair shining in the sun. "About 10 minutes, I should think." Oh, well, if we shall so soon be back on the right path, we might as well go with you, said Mr. Scornful. So off they all went, with Trickery, Bluff, and Miss Gamble. Anna danced in front, calling to Bluff to raise her. He ran after her, and suddenly poor Anna gave a dreadful scream. I'm in a bog, she cried. My feet are sinking. The grass was very green where Anna was. This was the only sign that the ground had suddenly become marshy. Poor Anna was sinking fast in the boggy ground, and Trickery was sinking with her. Quick, we must pull Anna out, cried Peter, and he ran to help. But alas, his feet too were caught in the marsh, and he began to flounder about, trying to get back to the hard ground. Mr. Scornful had a rope round his burden to keep it from dragging on his shoulders too much. He undid it quickly and threw it to Anna. She caught it and began to pull herself back to safety. Trickery held on to her and dragged her down with his weight. Let go, shouted Peter in a rage. You are pulling my sister down. Anna and Trickery were at last got back to the hard ground. Anna was sobbing and covered with slush. The others dried her as best they could. Then Mr. Scornful turned to Trickery and his friends. See what you nearly led us into? He said angrily. That must be the marsh of dishonesty. By following you, we were nearly caught in it. It has never been there before, said Bluff, turning his honest-seeming eyes onto Mr. Scornful. But they dropped before that man's hard gaze. Mr. Scornful had often been a rogue himself and tricked others. He knew now that the three travellers were rogues too. He turned aside and called to the others. We must get back to the right path. Rocky as it looked, it will be better than falling into this marsh. They set off back again, with Trickery, Bluff, and Harriet Gamble behind them. But they could not seem to find the way back, and it was not long before they found their feet sinking into squelchy ground. Anna was terrified after her experience and cried with fright. Soon it seemed as if the marsh lay all around them. It smelt evil. Mist rose here and there from it. It was flat and horrible, with big tufts of rough-looking grass here and there. This is terrible, cried Gracie Grumble. Really terrible. We shall never get out. Whatever are we to do? It looks as if there might be hard ground over there, said Mr. Scornful, pointing. Let's try to make our way there. But it wasn't a bit of use. Everyone began to sink, and poor Mr. Scornful, with his heavy burden, sank right up to his knees and found great difficulty in getting his feet out again. And indeed, no sooner had he got them out than they sank down once more. Night began to fall. The children were frightened and called to the grown-ups. Oh, do find a way out. We are so afraid. Isn't there any way through this horrible marsh? Mrs. Cornful asked Trickery, who was floundering about beside him. Surely there must be some path. I've never heard of any, said Trickery sullenly. Mrs. Cornful, don't you remember that the map showed this marsh? It was called the Marsh of Dishonesty, said Gracie suddenly. And through it were the stepping stones of truth. If only we could find them. Never heard of them, said Trickery. Dick Cowardly was in a terrible state. He clung on to Gracie, and she tried to shake him off. You ought to be ashamed of yourself, she scolded him. Why, even the children behave more bravely than you. The worst of it is, you make us even more frightened when you show us you're so afraid yourself. Suddenly a light showed not far off. It was the light from a lantern. Mr. Scornful hailed the light with joy. Hey there, we're lost in the marsh. Can you help us? A voice came over the marsh. Are you from the land of far beyond? If you are, I will certainly help you. There was a silence. Not one of the travellers was from the land of far beyond. All of them came from the city of turmoil. Then Trickery answered in a silky sort of voice. Friend, we are from the land of far beyond and have lost our way. Help us. We turned aside from the path to help someone who had lost the way, cried Bluff untruthfully. And now we need help ourselves. We will pay you highly if you help us, called Harriet Gamble, who hadn't a penny in the world. How many of you are there? Cried the voice, and the lantern flashed towards them. Oh, quite a number. Well, three of you say you are from the land of far beyond, and I am allowed to help those. But what about the others? Are they also from the land?
We'd better say we are, or we shall be left here to drown, said Mr. Scornful in a low voice to Dick and Gracie.
But Peter answered first, I am not from the land of far beyond, but I want to go there, and have lost my way, he cried in a ringing voice. Tell me where the path lies that goes through the marsh safely. I want to take my sisters to safety. They wish to go to the far beyond land too. I am allowed to help those who are on their way there, said the voice. Go a little to your left, boy. You will come to some stones that are laid across the marsh to the path where I am.
Peter scrambled off to the left, his feet sinking in with a squelching sound as he went. With great joy, he felt his feet scraping a big flat stone. He stood on it and held out his hand to Anna and Patience. He pulled them up beside him and then caught the gleam of another white stone in the half-darkness. He jumped to it, and the girls came too. Then, one by one, the others clambered over the marsh to join them, and soon the whole company was safely on the stepping stones of truth. Trickery, Bluff, and Harriet Gamble were the last, for they had sunk so deeply into the marsh that they found it difficult to make their way to the flat stones. Peter led the way to where the lantern light shone steadily. By the time he reached it, night had fallen completely, and darkness lay all around. They had only just been rescued in time. The boy was about to thank his rescuer when he heard yells from the marsh behind. The little company turned and strained their eyes through the darkness. The shouts came from Trickery, Bluff, and Harriet Gamble.
Help! Help! We've lost the stones! We are sinking again!
You will soon find them, cried the man with the lantern. I am going to take these people safely from the marsh and show them the rest of the stepping stones. In any case, there is someone else coming along in a minute. He will help you. The man took up his lantern and led the way over rather damp ground to where more white stepping stones lay. The children shivered, for the night was misty in the marsh. Peter was rather worried about the three left behind.
Will they really find their way onto the stones again? Asked the boy.
If they are honest folk, they will, said the man. If they are not, it will do them no harm to spend the night amid the terrors of the marsh of dishonesty. I am Mr. Straight, and I always help decent folk, but Mr. Crooked will be along here soon too, and will help them out if necessary. But oh, what a dance he will lead them through the marsh, for he takes a great delight in deceiving others, and he will probably desert them in the middle of their trouble. It is very difficult to help people like your three friends there.
They are not our friends, said Anna. We fell in with them, and they took us the wrong way. We wanted to get to the House of Peace by nightfall, but now we shan't, because it is dark already.
No, you are right away from the House of Peace, said Mr. Straight, swinging his lantern so that its rays showed up the long line of white stepping stones. You will have to lie by the wayside tonight, and do your best to sleep there. My house lies on the other side of the marsh, or you could shelter there. He brought them safely over the stepping stones to hard ground. How marvelous it was to feel the earth solid and hard under their feet, instead of soft and treacherous. There is the narrow path again, said Mr. Straight, and he shone his lantern onto it. There are high hedges just here, which keep off the wind. Rest there until daylight. I must go back into the marsh to see if there are any other folk to be helped. Good night. He disappeared into the darkness, his lantern making a round speck of light that grew smaller and smaller as he walked over the marsh. Everyone was very tired. It was much warmer now they had left the marsh, and the hedges made a sheltered spot. They all found as comfortable places as they could, and sat or lay down to rest. Soon most of them were asleep.
How easy it is to leave the path, said Mr. Scornful to Gracie, yawning widely.
Well, nothing will make me turn aside from it tomorrow, and I won't let anyone else either. But he was wrong. All kinds of queer things happened to the little company the next day.
The end of chapter 7.
How easy it is to be tricked, especially when an easy option is given, eh? So what else lies ahead?
Well, I can't wait to find out. If you would like to read this book, search it up online as it is in the public domain. Otherwise, please join me in the next chapter, for I would love to have you for company. Till the next time, go grab yourself a book, read, and let your imagination take you anywhere. Be anyone and do anything. And do share your reads in the comments. Would love to know. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.